28-year-old male hairdresser with complaints of chest pain for past 1 month and palpitation for past 1 month.
Wait.
Okay, sir.
There's a problem. Wait.
Okay, sir.
So this 28-year-old male hairdresser is complaining of chest pain and palpitation. Tell me how to take history of chest pain and how to take history of palpitation.
So for chest pain, we'll ask for any feature. When is this chest pain? The time of chest pain, that is continuous or intermittent, and the site of chest pain, whether it is localized or diffuse, any radiation of this pain, what is the character of the pain, and duration, how much time it lasts on each episode. Any other associated symptoms like vomiting, sweating, and any exacerbating or relieving factors for the pain, any associated breathlessness, how is it progressing, that is it increasing or any on and off periods for the pain.
You mean aggravating and relieving factors?
Yes, sir.
What is your aim of taking history of chest pain?
Sir, we need to find out whether it is due to cardiac cause, pulmonary cause, or any other cause for the pain.
Can you just tell any other cause? What do you mean by that?
Sir, any musculoskeletal disease.
Good. What else?
Esophageal disease.
Esophageal disease. That's fine. Now let's go to history of palpitation in this patient. What all things you want to know from palpitation?
Palpitation. It can be a physiological palpitation, that is anxiety. Mainly any due to anxiety, then any other, if diabetes, any history of any diabetes, anemia, any fever, the alcohol intake.
How does alcohol produce
palpitation?
How does alcohol produce palpitation? Okay. So history taking, chest pain and palpitation, how do you proceed? So chest pain, what are the points you have to mention? Location, why do you want to know the location?
Sir, in the case of angina or a myocardial infarction, it is mainly retrosternal pain.
What about esophageal pain?
Then, the esophageal pain, it will also be retrosternal, and also it can be in epigastrium also.
Okay, what about dissection?
In case of dissection, interscapular pain will be, on the back side also pain will be present. And also retrosternal.
Pericardial pain.
Retrosternal and also sometimes left-sided pain can be present.
Pericardial pain characteristically retrosternal, and it radiates to the margin of the trapezius.
Okay.
And anginal pain, myocardial pain, it is retrosternal, so also esophageal pain. Pleuritic pain, where do you get it?
Pleuritic pain will be localized, sir.
It will be on the side, not central.
Side.
Okay. Okay. Quality of the pain. What do you make out of the quality of the pain?
Sir, constricting or heavy type of pain?
Splitting type of pain, unbearable, is characteristic of?
Aortic dissection.
Dissection. What about the chronology?
Yes, sir.
Chronology of chest pain. What is the sequence?
Time.
What is the duration
the
of
timing?
Anginal pain?
It will be for 2 to 10 minutes.
What's the maximum time you can have angina? Less than?
1 to 2 minutes.
Less than 20 minutes. And myocardial infarction pain? Myocardial infarction pain?
It is prolonged.
More than 30 minutes. And then a little bit of ache may continue. So these are chronology. So you want to know the duration.
Okay.
Suppose somebody gets pain 30 seconds and disappears. Again comes 30 second, lightning pain. What will you suspect? That's very characteristic feature of pain arising from your nerves.
I guess.
Intercostal nerve, irritation of the root pain. Same thing happens if there is a pre-herpetic or post-herpetic pain. What about the quantity of pain?
Quantity.
Unbearable, bearable, that's all individual variation. Quality and quantity are all variable from person to person. It depends upon your vocabulary, your capacity to express what exactly it is. The quality and quantity you cannot estimate, but unbearable is usually characteristic of situations like dissection.
Dissection.
Right. What is setting where you get chest pain? What will you ask about setting?
Sir.
A person says, I am getting severe retrosternal pain after drinking ice water. What do you think?
Any vagal stimulation?
It is very characteristic of esophageal spasm. Esophageal spasm.
Sir.
Okay. But if you are getting pain while you are swallowing, that is esophagitis.
Okay.
When you are walking uphill, if you get chest pain, that is suggestive of anginal pain. When you take deep breath, if you get pain, it is pleuritic pain. You are sitting idle.
Okay, sir.
Suddenly pain will come on the side, you suspect it can be something like pneumothorax or something like a pulmonary embolism.
Yes, sir.
Setting and background is important. What about the aggravating relieving factors?
So, anginal pain can be triggered by any emotions or exertion.
Physical or emotional exercise, okay.
Yes, sir.
What about associated symptoms? You are talking about associated symptoms. What are associated symptoms you get?
Any vomiting.
Which condition associated with vomiting?
Esophageal pain, spasm.
You can have pain, you can vomiting. GERD in hiatus hernia can vomiting. But more serious illnesses like inferior wall myocardial infarction can present as vomiting.
Okay, sir.
Any other symptom you ask when somebody has got chest pain? Associated symptoms indicate the severity. And somebody is sweating, he has palpitation, he has dyspnea, restlessness, that goes commonly along with myocardial pain.
Okay.
So by analyzing chest pain, what all diagnosis you can get? You already said angina, you said myocardial infarction, you said pericarditis, pulmonary embolism, dissection, chest wall disease. How do you get characteristic features by analyzing? How can you say chest wall pain?
Sir, there will also be tenderness.
They will usually point with a finger. It will not be diffuse. Myocardial pain is never pointed. It is
localized.
Patient cannot say with the finger tip where the pain is in myocardial infarction. So what is Levine's sign? That's a very useful sign.
Leve fist. In myocardial infarction, the patient tells that the pain is like a fist.
In Levine's sign is a fist. Well, we ask the patient to point. If you point with your fingertip, that rules out myocardial infarction.
Myocardial infarction. Okay, sir.
Okay. So, from this history, you can also get clues about gastrointestinal diseases, gastroesophageal reflux disease. You can have esophagitis, peptic ulcer disease, ERD, and spasm. Last but not least, we must always think about MVP, which can produce chest pain.
Okay. Okay, sir.
So, how do you analyze palpitation now? What's the mechanism of palpitation? Tell me, how do people get palpitation? What's the mechanism?
Increased heart rate,
arrhythmia. So, alteration the rate, either tachycardia or bradycardia. So tachycardia produce situation, anxiety, fight, fright,
exercise.
Running, exercise produce palpitation. So it is all related to rate. So alteration in rate can produce problem. Second mechanism is alteration rhythm. If you get one or two ectopics, you will immediately come to know that something is wrong. If your heart is irregular, then you know something is wrong. So alteration in the rhythm. The third mechanism is alteration the force of contraction of the chambers. The chambers are forcefully contracting, you will feel the thump of the heartbeat, and that's the third mechanism. So how do you analyze palpitation? What all things you ask next?
So regular or irregular?
Good.
The present continuously or onset, that is abrupt onset.
Good.
Then it is short lived or continuous, and also recurrence, how often it recurs if short lived. Then pain followed by palpitation. It is present at rest or only while exertion. Any associated syncope.
Right. So, mechanism of palpitation, we said three mechanisms are there. And when you analyze palpitation, the first step is you tell the patient to mimic palpitation. As the patient put down one hand, the opposite hand, they can show you how the palpitation is. Ask them to mimic the rate and rhythm. So if he is tapping very fast, you know it's a tachyarrhythmia. And if he's tapping irregularly, you know it's a irregular rhythm. So best thing is ask the patient to mimic it by putting your finger on top of the other hand, and you can show how it is done. And starting time, at what time started, that means abrupt onset indicates usually supraventricular or tachyarrhythmias. But if you are doing some exercise, your palpitation will gradually increase as the exercise increases. So insidious onset. So physiological situations, insidious, pathological situation, you find abrupt onset. And what is the activities at onset? That also tell you what is the possible etiology. And onset abrupt and a tachyarrhythmia coming episodically. Paroxysmal tachycardias, not only the onset, and they will also be aberrant. And whether the patient has counted how long it lasted, and then you ask for associated symptoms. Patient can tell it's regular or irregular. Patient will tell, I have got more symptoms than that. So these are two symptoms of this patient, and we have analyzed accordingly. Okay, so this patient has got occasional palpitation. Patient does not know it's regular or irregular. Okay, so review symptoms. What all things you would like to do in such a situation? Young man with palpitation, chest pain, what all things you want to review?
Respiratory system.
Yes.
Any breathlessness.
That's correct.
Then CNS, any syncope, loss of consciousness.
Good, good. So what is Stokes Adams attack? Since you said about loss of consciousness, people sometimes, because of arrhythmias, bradyarrhythmias particularly, they lost consciousness and fall to the ground. And you may think it's only a case of syncope. So underlying severe heart disease is there. You have to detect it by clinical examination. Sometimes they may throw some seizure-like activity also. So you can mimic an epilepsy. So loss of consciousness, you'll ask what else?
GIT symptoms.
You will ask.
Vomit.
Anything else you want to ask? So what's the idea of reviewing the system? To find out the etiology, to find out what is happening. So what are the causes of palpitation? We should never miss thyroid disease.
Thyroid.
It's commonly missed. Tobacco use, too much coffee, too much tea, caffeine by and large can produce palpitation, alcohol, colas, and people may be taking stimulants or amphetamines. So this is what we have to review in detail, because these things are not commonly revealed by the patient. Patient will not tell how much coffee, tea he consumes, how much he smokes, how much alcohol he consumes. He may not tell you. But that may be the only problem, the young man with the palpitation. You reduce these things, he may come down normal. It's on examination, this is the finding.
Okay, sir. On general examination, 6 feet tall, limb span normal, BMI is 23, pulse rate is 82 per minute, BP is 120/80 mmHg, and otherwise, unremarkable.
So what? Yeah.
So here, yes. Pulse rate has increased.
Yeah. What is pulse rate?
Okay. So 82.
What is normal? Pulse rate? No, what is normal pulse rate?
So 60 to 100.
So why do you say it's increased? Okay. Okay. So pulse is okay. Blood pressure is okay. Okay. He's fine.
Okay.
So what? Yes, what more you want to look for?
Thyroid.
So, in a person who is tall, we have to look for features of Marfan. Marfanoid features.
Marfan.
You have to measure his upper segment and lower segment ratio. You have to check for is arachnodactyly, high arched palate. You have to look for iridodonesis. You have to look for chest wall deformities, spine deformities, feet deformities, anything abnormal you look. This patient's findings are like this.
Serious precordium is normal, apex feet normal. No left parasternal heave. S1 is loud. S2 normal. A systolic murmur heard. Few clicks are present over the apex.
So, what is apex beat?
The apex meat is the outermost and the lowermost area of precordium where a cardiac impulse is felt.
Lowermost and outermost. Lowermost and outermost.
Outermost.
So, what all things you want to look for now? You have got a murmur here. So what all?
Yes, sir.
What all
things, systolic murmur.
What all details you want about it?
Sir, the quality of the murmur, high pitch or low pitch, and site of the murmur where we can see any associated thrills, any radiation of the murmur, and best heart.
So how is a murmur produced?
Murmur is due to the turbulence of the blood flow.
Proportionate to the size of the orifice through which it is passing. Depends upon the pressure
passing.
Gradient. Okay, or gradient across the narrowing, wherever it is. So there's a murmur is produced. Okay. Then few clicks are heard.
Yes,
what do you think?
Sir, it can be ejection systolic click.
Ejection click, okay. So, what all things you want to talk in this patient?
Any valvular disease?
When you get multiple clicks over the apex and systolic murmur is heard, what is your possible provisional diagnosis?
Aortic stenosis.
Okay. So, aortic stenosis is not possible even.
Mitral valve prolapse.
Well, so in that situation, you look for skeletal abnormalities, you look for connective tissue diseases, you look for valve prolapse or other valves, and you look for complications. Okay. Now,
okay,
tell me how to describe a murmur. You didn't ask more details about the murmur. I wanted to tell all the details of murmur. How do you describe a murmur?
Yes, sir. High pitched or low pitched murmur. Pitch of the murmur.
Yes. What factor decides the pitch? Pitch decides the quality. So, frequency decides the pitch. High frequency,
okay.
Low frequency. Accordingly, the description of the pitch can be, pitch and quality go together. You say the murmur is harsh, murmur is rumbling, scratchy, grunting, blowing, squeak, vibratory, or you say musical. These are all going with the pitch and the quality. What next thing you will look for?
Sir, timing.
Timing, yes, very good.
That is
what
systolic murmur.
Yes, systolic murmur.
Or diastolic murmur.
Diastolic murmur. Any other murmur?
Sir, continuous murmur.
Continuous murmur. So, what is meant by systolic murmur?
Sir, it is heard between S1 and S2.
This particular patient has got a systolic murmur over the apex. So,
yes,
what are the four different types of systolic murmurs?
Pan-systolic murmur.
Yes.
Ejection systolic murmur.
Yes.
Mid systolic murmur.
So you have what? Early systolic murmur. Early systolic murmur means the murmur obscures the first heart sound. That's what happens in mitral regurgitation, tricuspid regurgitation, VSD. So it obscures the first heart sound. That's called as early systolic murmur.
Systolic murmur.
Then you have got mid-systolic murmur, which is otherwise called as ejection systolic murmur. It occurs after S1. There is minimum gap between the murmur and S1. And it ends before S2. It does not touch S2. It does not touch S1. Okay. First heart sound starts at the isovolemic systole, and the murmur starts when the ejection takes place. Right, it's called as ejection systolic murmur or mid systolic murmur. Then we have what is called as holosystolic murmur. Holosystolic murmur is what you said as pan systolic murmur, starts with the first heart sound and goes to the second heart sound as mitral regurgitation, tricuspid regurgitation, or VSD. And you have a fourth type of systolic murmur known as
late systolic murmur.
It does not touch the first heart sound. It starts later on mid systole or late systole and end with the second heart sound. Okay, you said the second type of murmur is diastolic murmur. What are the different types of diastolic murmurs?
Early diastolic murmur.
It starts with A2 and goes for a variable time. Classical example is aortic regurgitation. Second type is called
mid diastolic murmur.
Which condition? Example.
Mitral stenosis,
myxoma, Austin Flynn murmur, Carey Coombs murmur, and flow murmurs. So a couple of things are there. And tell me something about late diastolic murmurs. And the other term for this is pre-systolic murmur. Tell me about that.
Sir, it is also seen in mitral stenosis, that is pre-systolic accentuation, tricuspid stenosis,
and myxoma. Third type of murmur you said upon timing is continuous murmur. Can you define that?
Sir, it is heard, it starts from the S1 and is continuously heard throughout S1 and then S2, bridges across S2.
That last part is correct. It bridges across S2. It encompasses S2. But you said it starts with S1, need not be. And it ends with the S1, no, it need not be. It's a murmur starting in systole, crossing over the second sound. Can you give some examples of that?
Sir, patent ductus arteriosus.
Suppose you get a continuous murmur near the scapula and the back. What you will suspect? Sussman's sign in collaterals of quarters by our when you lean forward and trying to separate the scapula from the midline, you can see tortuous vessels there, and when you auscultate over here you may get a murmur. That can be continuous murmur. Okay.
Okay, sir.
Right. So you said about the pitch of the murmur. You said about the timing of the murmur.
Timing.
Two things you said. Yes. Third thing.
Yes, sir. Sir, character of the murmur.
Character of the murmur. We must all. What do you mean by character?
Sir, if it is rough and rumbling, soft blowing. So
that's
murmurs.
What you said. PH. That's what you said in pitch. No. Pitch and quality go together, I said.
Something about
grading of the murmur. Location is very important. Tell me about location. What decides the location?
Sir, valves, the region of
the
valve involved.
Murmurs are best heard at the site of the origin. Only thing is modified by tissue surround. If you are having emphysema, pneumothorax, pericardial effusion, obesity, it may be masked. Otherwise, site of origin, mitosis, marmosis, or head over the mitral area. Mitral regurgitation marmosis are basically over there. Aortic marmosis over there. Tricuspid marmosis over there. So site of origin, you get the marmor. So location is important. Yes. What else?
Okay. Sir,
what else?
Grading of mammas.
In systolic marmor, how many grades are there? Systolic marmor, how many grades?
6 grades.
6 grades are there. Diastolic marmor, some people say grading is there up to 4. Some people say there is no grading. Either way is okay with me. No problem. And you said radiation. Tell me about radiation.
In the case of aortic stenosis, it can be radiated towards carotid. And in the case of mitral regurgitation,
mitral regurgitation,
it can be radiated towards axilla.
So the basic principle is the murmurs radiate along the direction of flow of the blood. If blood is flowing to the neck, then it's along the carotid. If it's flowing to the left atria, depending upon is the anterior or posterior leaflet which is in trouble, you get radiation to the axilla or in the parasternal area. So radiation depends upon which direction the blood is flowing. So we have got now anatomical location, radiation of the murmur, you said the grade of the murmur, you said pitch of the murmur, quality of the murmur. One more thing you have left over there. Timing you said. Tell me the configuration of the murmur. Does it help you? Some murmurs will be going up. They are called as crescendo murmurs. Some murmurs will be going down. Like aortic regurgitation murmur, they are called as decrescendo murmur. And some murmurs will be going up and coming down like aortic stenosis. Crescendo, decrescendo murmurs. And some murmurs will be unchanged. It's called plateau murmurs. Plateau. So, configuration is also, you can analyze the murmur. So, this particular murmur, description is late systolic murmur. So, grade, pitch, configuration, location, radiation, timing, and you said systolic murmur, diastolic murmur. Today's class is basically we are talking about basic things, symptom analysis and sign analysis. So, that's why you are going to the descriptions. Chest pain, palpitation, description of murmurs, and you must know all the points. Now you said about clicks are present. What are these? What are these clicks?
Sir, sudden opening of valves.
Sudden tensing. Sudden tensing produces snapping sound. They are called clicks. How many types of clicks are there? Sorry. How many types of clicks are there?
Sir, two types.
What are they?
Sir, ejection clicks and non-ejection clicks.
When you use your stethoscope and auscultate, how will you know which is ejection click and what is ejection non-ejection click?
With this one, ejection click can be heard.
Clicks heard at the beginning of systole. So if you compare with your carotid artery by palpating before the carotid goes to the peak, the first one third, you are likely to get the ejection click. When it reaches the peak of carotid, thereafter or whatever you get is a non-ejection click. So what are the sources of ejection clicks?
Aortic stenosis, aortic valves, pulmonary stenosis,
pulmonary wall, and sometimes from dilated pulmonary artery wall. Dilated pulmonary artery can also give clicks. So what does clicks indicate to you? If you find a click from the aortic wall, what does it indicate to you?
Sir, whether the valve is mobile or any.
The click is produced only if the valve is pliable. Once it becomes fibrosed, calcified, click disappears. So,
okay, sir.
That is the importance of looking for click. And
click.
A murmur with a click localizes the lesion in the valve cusps rather than supravalvular or subvalvular stenosis. So, click can localize anatomically. Click can tell you the valve is pliable, and click can be clue to the severity of the aortic stenosis. What is the basic difference between pulmonary click and aortic click? How will you differentiate?
Pulmonary click is better heard on inspiration.
The murmurs, pulmonary murmurs are better heard on inspiration. Aortic murmurs are best heard on expiration. This is not applicable to clicks. The aortic clicks do not move with respiration. Aortic click do not move with respiration. But pulmonary clicks becomes prominent on expiration. Pulmonary clicks becomes prominent on expiration. Point number two is aortic clicks can be heard all over the precordium. Pulmonary clicks will be well localized to a particular area. So, ejection click and non-ejection click, aortic click and pulmonary click, we have differentiated. So, what is the possible diagnosis in this patient?
The patient is having a systolic, a late systolic murmur, and with clicks, more possibility of mitral valve prolapse.
So, what are the maneuvers you want to do to confirm the diagnosis?
Standing position.
You auscultated standing and lying, squatting and lying.
Standing.
And you do isometric contraction. How will you make the isometric contractions? Fist. Just hold fist tightly.
Okay.
That's isometric contraction. Then you do Valsalva maneuver. You know how to do Valsalva. All of you know. So you see whether these murmurs are changing or not. Right? Yes,
sir.
What is the physiology of these maneuvers? What is the physiology of these maneuvers?
Sir, it is based on left ventricular size.
Nice. Change the size of the ventricles and see the response of the murmurs. Okay. To increase or decrease the severity of prolapse. So there are situations where left ventricular size decreases, like Valsalva, standing, sitting.
Standing.
These three situations you find left ventricle
size decreases.
Decreases in size, and accordingly, the prolapse will take place early and it becomes severe. Left ventricular size increases in squatting and raising the legs, and size of the ventricle become more. So prolapse become less severe. So you see the change of murmur by doing Valsalva maneuver, make the patient stand, sit, squat, raise the legs. Then you can see the difference. Now look at this picture. Now first picture on the left side is when the patient is lying down. You can see size of his ventricles, and you can see the size of his click and the murmur, and you are making the patient stand up, and blood is pooling in the lower limb blood vessels. So lesser amount of blood goes to the heart. Heart becomes smaller.
Smaller in size.
So the prolapse become early. So click has moved towards S1, and it has become more prominent, and the murmur also has become more prominent. you make the patient squat, make the patient squat, or you raise the legs. You can support and raise the leg and see what happens. You find that the return to the heart increases, heart slightly dilates, and the click goes back towards S2, become fainter, and the murmur also become fainter. This is the basic principle of these maneuvers. The collective, they are called as dynamic auscultation. This type of auscultation is useful also to diagnose hypertrophic obstructive cardiomyopathies. So what's the etiology of MVP? Why do people get MVP?
It's a myxomatous change in the leaflet mainly.
So degenerative changes. So usually degeneration occurs at what age?
As a elderly.
So this is in young 60. People. So this may not be the whole truth. There is something more than that. So, and it is found to be associated with a couple of connective tissue diseases like osteogenesis imperfecta, Marfan syndrome, pseudoxanthoma elasticum, Ehlers Danlos. These are all situations where connective tissue is not properly developed and the mitral valve becomes redundant and the valve apparatus becomes longer. So it projects back into the left atria. And this disease can run in families in an autosomal dominant fashion, or sometimes sporadically also you can see. What are the common symptoms of MVP? You should be having symptomatic.
Okay, more common in females.
True. The question is about
pain.
Symptoms. You are telling
chest
about
pain.
Female. Chest pain is one symptom.
Yes, sir. Then palpitation.
Palpitation number two. 10% of the population has got MVP but no symptoms. So incidental detection. Or they come with the complications and related symptoms. So asymptomatic chest pain, palpitation, sometimes TAA, sometimes some arrhythmias, sometimes infant endocarditis, and then related symptoms will be there. Okay, what are the signs of MVP? You already mentioned. There may be
systolic murmur.
Systolic murmurs. Mitral regurgitation murmurs. What are associations of MVP? Skeletal abnormalities. Prolapse of tricuspid valve, aortic valve, hypomastia, and sometimes von Willebrand disease. Okay. How will you investigate to confirm MVP? MVP is a clinical diagnosis, but investigation required is echocardiogram to confirm the diagnosis. That's compulsory to confirm. Okay, what's the clinical thinking, clinical diagnosis? Echocardiogram, they got their own criteria that the valve must, leaflet portion of the valve must go more than 2 cm above the annulus. Then only they will say it is prolapsed. So, what's the prognosis of these patients? Mitral valve. Prolapse can have three fashions. One is only click, two murmur, three click with murmur. Those with clicks, nothing happened, they go as normal people. People with murmur, they may develop into full-fledged mitral regurgitation, and then their prognosis, outlook, everything is just like mitral regurgitation. Others will be absolutely okay. Unless complicated by complications. What are the indications for prophylaxis for infected endocarditis?
So, coexisting mitral regurgitation.
Commonly, prophylaxis for endocarditis is not given for MVP, but given just like any other valvular lesion, provided you had endocarditis earlier. Otherwise, prophylaxis is not required. Same as in general population. Okay. What are the complications?
Yes, heart failure.
Rare.
Pulmonary hypertension.
They go for mitral regurgitation and all the complications of mitral regurgitation. But they are candidates for infective endocarditis. And sometimes they get arrhythmias, supraventricular arrhythmias. Rarely it is postulated to be a cause for sudden death. And then they may have associations and complications association. They may have skeletal abnormalities. And common association will be skeletal abnormalities, von Willebrand disease, hypomastia. So these are the common associations of MVP. So questions. Who is answering questions today? Abhishek? Who else is there? How do you classify MVP? What is classic MVP? What's MVP syndrome? How do you treat MVP? Questions. Anybody to answer here? So, classical MVP is MVP. The classification, you can declassify into classic and non-classic. Classic is when it's thickened, more than 5 millimeters. Non-classic is when it's not thickened. MVP can be classified according to with mitral regurgitation, without mitral regurgitation. Then we can say mitral wall prolapse syndrome. You say MVP syndrome when there are extra cardiac manifestations like chest pain, palpitation, dyspnea, exercise intolerance, dizziness, anxiety, and EC changes. What are the EC changes expected? Commonly, you may get T wave inversion in lead 2-3 AVF, that's called inferior leads. Okay, what are the common skeletal abnormalities you look for in these patients? They may have very narrow AP diameter. They may have scoliosis. Normal people have got kyphosis at the level of thoracic spine. When this kyphosis is lost, you get straight back syndrome. So, if your thoracic spine is normally concave to accommodate heart, becomes straight, the AP diameter will become smaller and the heart will be compressed anteriorly posteriorly and you may get some murmurs. This is called as straight back syndrome. And you may get pectus excavatum also as a sign. What's the treatment option? Symptomatic patient require treatment. MR has to be followed up. And the follow-up of MVP patients is because like this, people with clicks only, you leave them alone, no follow-up. People with the murmur must undergo echocardiogram every year. Yearly echocardiogram is compulsory. And if they at any time go for atrial fibrillation, anticoagulate them. And if they develop TIA, you can give them antiplatelet drugs. So the final diagnosis in this case is maybe?
Mitral valve prolapse.
That's all. That's all. Yes,
okay,
good. Mitral valve prolapse.